declaring the end from the beginning. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. May the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. Bear fruit to God, that your fruit should remain.
A heartfelt shalom set apart believers, grace and peace from our heavenly Abba, through his Son, Jesus the Messiah, Yahushua HaMashiach. Thanks for tuning in as we continue our endeavor in our comparative study of our three-part being, spirit, soul, and body, in the person of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden narrative. For such a time as this, it is wise for us to clearly know our purpose and gain practical understanding of the need for Paul's admonition in 1 Thessalonians 5:23, where it says, "Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Master Jesus Christ, Yahushua HaMashiach." If you haven't already, watch the previous videos to get a fuller picture of the unique purpose established by the Creator in Adam and Eve, and how we can apply these same principles in our own spirit and soul, and how we can apply them practically in how we manage and how we live our lives. In Genesis 2:7, we saw that the neshama breathed into Adam's flesh, made him a unique living being. Before the fall, the life of Adam was in the neshama, or breath of the Creator. By now, you're well familiar with the typology I've repeated over and over again in these video series, in that Adam is a type of spirit. When you put two and two together, let's say that the life of the spirit is in the breath. We then took notice that the woman was formed from Adam's side. And so we refer to the woman, also known as Eve, as a type of soul. This initial separation was necessary for them to cleave one to another in their union. But we also know about the fall of mankind. Adam and Eve experienced further separation, and this was evidenced by them being expelled from the garden. And this time, they were separated from direct fellowship with their Creator. In this presentation, we will further our understanding as to why I see that what was meant for evil against Eve, the Most High has meant for good. Their separation from the garden was a provision for reconciliation, and with Adam and Eve to have an experiential mastery of this first, so that they would be sufficiently equipped and empowered to reach the whole world with the message of salvation. Let's begin by bringing a few things to your attention about separation. You know, death also means separation between two things, physical and spiritual death. And there are scriptures to support this statement. For now, let's think about this. If there are two deaths, then it would also then imply that there would be two lives. Genesis 2:7 seem to have given us a clue. You see, the word chi appears twice in this text. The life of the neshama, or breath of the Creator, and the chi preceding the word nefesh, or living being. Would it surprise you that in the same chapter, we would also see the word death appear twice? But you won't see it in the English text. You need to take a peek at the Hebrew. Genesis 2:17 says, "But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die." The Hebrew word for die is muth, which means to die, to be put to death, or to die prematurely. Now, the word surely in Hebrew is also the same word, muth. If I was translating this, I would be scratching my head wondering why this word appears twice. And so, to make it grammatically accepted, I'll probably translate it as surely die as well, just the way it's written in the text, to make it easy for those who read the English language. But personally, I do believe that the sovereign creator purposely hid these little gems back then to be unearthed for such a time as this. We live in the last of days, and the Most High is deepening revelation for us to equip and prepare us for the modern issues that we are dealing with today. So we see life twice when Adam was formed, and we see death twice for disobeying the commandment, which was also confirmed by the serpent in his dialogue with the woman. Interestingly though, pay attention to Eve's response to the serpent when asked to recite the commandment to refrain from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Either she lacked comprehension or perhaps overlooked an important detail, since her response in the text is missing the second word, death. This is a hint of Eve's weaker disposition, which we can see is the reason why her stand was compromised easily. Before the fall, in Genesis 2:7, we see living or chi appear twice. Remember, Adam is a type of spirit, and what made him a living being is the breath of the Lord God. So the life of the spirit is in the breath. At this point, Adam's living being composed only of flesh and bone. It is after the fall, as a consequence to Eve's disobedience, that mankind put on flesh and blood. The life of the spirit is in the breath, but the life of the flesh is in the blood. This is key for us to pay attention to, since this seems to be a key factor in our restoration and our reconciliation to enter back into fellowship with our Creator, back in His Garden of Eden. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 15:50, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. We will look at this in detail at a future presentation. But for now, we have to ponder Paul's statement here. And it really begs the question as to why flesh and blood is excluded from the kingdom of God. What's different before and after the fall? That blood is now part of the equation. Let's look again at Genesis 2:7. Take note of chi nefesh present in the Hebrew text. Remember, the life of the spirit is in the breath. But after the fall, in Genesis 3:17 and 20, mysteriously, nefesh is no longer included in the Hebrew text when the Creator is referring to Adam and Eve's new living conditions as part of the consequence of Eve's disobedience. Now remember this, the life of the flesh is in the blood. After eating of the forbidden fruit, they realized they were naked as a result of the disobedience, and atonement or covering is needed. Remember Eve, a type of soul, and Adam, a type of Messiah, as referred to in the typology by Paul in Romans 5:14. Let's now look at this word atonement. Leviticus 17:11 says, for the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that maketh an atonement for the soul. Now, people assume that the covering took place in Genesis 3:21, when the Lord God made coats of skins and clothed them. But we see that blood is for covering our souls. The covering mentioned in Genesis 3:21 is skin. So what was their covering before the fall? And that's just another idea which we will address in the next presentation. So blood is needed to atone for the sin of the soul. In Genesis 1, we see that there is no mention of blood. Even when Eve was taken from Adam's rib, Adam himself specified Eve is from bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. Remember, the life of the spirit is in the breath. The life of the flesh is in the blood. Now, for us to see blood, we need to examine the word Adam. You will see the Hebrew word Dam, D-A-M, which means blood. A few things you should know about the word Adam, in that there are notable variations of the transliteration of this word in Genesis 1 and 2 and several other passages in the scripture. The most common Hebrew word used in the creation account is Adam, or Strong's H120, which means mankind or man, or think of it as a kind of man. Another transliteration is Strong's H127, Adama, which means land or ground. Adam has connections to the land or ground. Note that this is not the same dry land noted in Genesis 1. We discussed this in the previous video. Our clue is in Genesis 2:6, because it says, "A mist went up from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground." Here, that word Adama is found. Another transliteration that we want to take a closer look at is the word Adam, Strong's H121. This means red or ruddy. Think of the color of blood. This is seen for the first time in Genesis 2:21, when Adam was put to deep sleep. Please note that this is even before Eve came to being. But this deep sleep is not the same sleep as you and I understand sleep today. I believe this is a withdrawal from the neshama infused into him by the Most High. This deep sleep is a departure from his complete consciousness of the one who gave him breath. He had to be made lower in disposition, in preparation to die for his bride. Remember, the man Adam is immersed in the spirit or the ruach of the Almighty, filled by his neshama. Even a dose or a small measure of the ruach of the Most High God Creator would not qualify Adam to taste death. In the scripture it says, when you walk in the spirit, you cannot fulfill the lust of the flesh. Adam is a type of Messiah, and we see in Hebrews 2:14, where it says, "Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is, the devil." This also makes Revelation 13:18 a bit more understandable in our finite minds at least, where it says, "The lamb slain from the foundation of the world." I'd like to coin the term red man. Adam, in a sense, became the red man in advance or in predestination of his purpose, as Paul would label him as a type of Messiah who is to come. And we see a hint of this confirmed in 1 Peter 1:2. "According to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in the sanctification of the Spirit for obedience to Jesus Christ and for sprinkling with his blood." Now the next one, this red man Adam, appears is in Genesis 5, Joshua 3:16, and Job 31:33. Now, Job 31:33 is quite interesting because it says, "If I have covered my transgressions as Adam by hiding my iniquity in my bosom." So Job is making a parallel of covering or atonement as Adam did. And the word Adam there is Strong's H121. In other words, the red man. So when Adam and Eve was covered with coats of skin by the Creator, that was just it, a skin covering. Why, you might ask? Well, by the mercies of the Most High, He is preparing them to go outside of Eden and face a strange and alien environment. The living conditions are so different and incomparable to what was their home in Eden. Adam and Eve literally needed skin to be protected and survive this new world. The point is, we need to see more than the Sunday school coloring books of Adam and Eve. There's more to the narrative than meets the eye here. The Creator formed Adam from dry earth, breathed the Lord God's being into him, and put him, Adam, in a place set apart from the known world. This enclosed place of delight that the Creator himself planted or established, where the Creator himself caused the trees to grow. The Creator himself formed the beast of the field. Note that in Genesis 1, the earth is the one that gave birth to the plants and herbs. The earth is the one that brought forth the living creatures. These are key and important distinction between Genesis 1 and 2 that I'd just like for you to take a mental note of for future presentations. In the meantime, in Isaiah 62:4, you see a picture of marriage between a person that's referred to as Hezbah and a land referred to as Beulah land. So Garden of Eden is Beulah land, which means land married. And so man, or Adam, was in covenant or in holy matrimony with the Creator in the garden. In Genesis 2:15, the first mention of the word took, we gloss over this and don't think much of it. But the Hebrew word lachash, Strong's H3947, which means take in marriage. And this account is before the formation of Eve. Now let's take a look at the purpose of the place that was set apart by the Most High for Adam to dwell in, the Garden of Eden. We see in Genesis 2:15, and the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. Here's another word we can easily look over, but holds another gem right before our eyes. Genesis 2:15, the word put in Hebrew is yanach, or Strong's H3240, which means to rest. So Adam was put in covenant in marriage with the Creator and was first put to rest in the garden, a set-apart place, a cooling place. We talked about how Adam was formed like clay by the potter. And just like freshly formed clay, it needs to strengthen first before it can be a fit vessel for the master's use. What is resting like in the garden? Well, let's take this verse and examine it further. Adam is to dress it. The Hebrew word there, it means to work or to serve. And Adam is to keep. The Hebrew word there is keep, guard, observe, or give heed. The potter places clay pots on shelves so that air can freely circulate around each piece. And if you ever force dry clay with something that forces extreme heat on it, it will be destroyed. So now do you see why Adam was first put to rest in the Garden of Eden? So he can rest in the cool of the day with the Creator. Let's take a stand back. Pause the video if you need to, and just appreciate the intricacy of the details and the disciplined approach of the Most High when He bowed the heavens down and descended from above to pick up dry dust and blew His neshama into the being of Adam, and how He created a place where heaven is on earth, where man, whom He formed after His image, is placed in this set-apart place to delight in Him, to worship, and to keep guard of His commandments. Even in our natural minds, we can understand the need for order in our own homes. You'd want to create a safe, comfortable place just right for your children to learn, to grow in love and then eventually carry your family name with honor to the outside world. To maintain this homeostasis of a home, you would need to have loving instructions set in order. Sons and daughters are expected to be in compliance and not at all to be legalistic, but to be loving, knowing the reality of life in the outside world. Fathers, mothers, how will it go when one day your son or daughter barges in the living room and starts demanding changes to your instructions and saying this and that is done away with? That is what happened to Eve in a sense, thinking she was old enough to be formulating her own rules by adding to the commandment. Whether adding or removing, it's all the same in the eyes of the Father. Our souls share the same mental disposition that Eve had that resulted in her action of disobedience. As mentioned before, take note in Genesis 2, and you will notice that the commandment was spoken and given to Adam alone. And so one of Adam's responsibility in the garden also is to teach his young bride the laws of the Creator. And since Adam is a type of our spirit, it lines up in what Paul would say in Romans 7:22, in that our inward man delights in the law of God. Romans 7:22 says, "For I delighted in the law of God according to the inward man." So if there is a part of us making excuses or unwilling to subject to the loving instructions of the Most High, then that is the Eve in us that still need to be nurtured and matured by the Spirit. We see in the New Covenant, Jesus the Messiah came to fulfill the law. According to Matthew 5:17, dig a little deeper in the Greek word fulfill to understand the heart of the Father, to understand what the Messiah came to do. The word fulfill, Strong's G4137 or pleru. Dig deeper in the root word of pleru. You will eventually see the word to consummate, which means to make complete in every particular, to render perfect, to carry through to the end, to accomplish, to carry out, or some undertaking. There are layers of dimension when it comes to relationships. We know that there is a progression from being an acquaintance, to being friends, to being engaged, and then to being engaged for marriage. And then after making vows and celebration of union, there comes the time for a much deeper appreciation of the union. Now, looking at the marriage certificate, a legal document, it is a written covenant, but we know that there is another dimension yet to be uncovered. By consummating the marriage, you bring life to your union. You will engage in levels of activity where the union is made complete in every particular way. And really, the consummation is carried out only in a set-apart marriage. In the same manner, Jesus fulfilled the law. The law or the marriage certificate was not shred to pieces or done away with. Jesus, Yahushua, brought the loving instructions of the Father to life in every particular way to carry you to the next level. Since Adam is a type of Messiah, his responsibility towards Eve, a type of soul, is to carry out or bring to life or realization what it means to be in complete obedience with the Father. You see, it's one thing to read or hear about truth. It is yet another to experience firsthand what it's like to have that experiential knowledge beyond our five senses. What it's like to be in relationship with the Father through His Son, Yahushua, Jesus the Messiah. Jesus is the Word. He is the expressed thoughts of the breath of the Creator. Then, Word had to become flesh so we can really know and experience the Creator through His Son. And so we can know Him. That word know in Hebrew is yada, to see with the eyes or the mind, hence know and understand. Lamentations 3:51 says, "My eye affects my heart." You see, another way to comprehend Jesus fulfilling the law for us is to think of entertainment. Now, we know that there are many devices nowadays when it comes to receiving entertainment, but let's look at the original device called television, invented in the late 19th century. Television, or tell their vision. Tele, from the Greek, it means to reach you from a distance. Someone is telling their vision from a distance. That's really what television is. The show transmitted via television. We have to understand that it starts off from a written script. In fact, the written script itself was birthed out of a collection of thoughts that became an elaborate idea that was then put on written pages, which was then projected to come to life by way of actors and actresses. The producers of the show decided to make what was a written script come to life. The written script was not done away with when the television show came on. It was merely fulfilled or carried out to the next level of appreciation, of understanding by the vision being projected on screen. Now, it is the same idea with the Word becoming flesh. Yahushua, Jesus the Messiah, fulfilling the law or the commandments for us. So Jesus carried out the laws or the instructions of the Most High perfectly when he walked here on earth. And he brought about a deeper appreciation, deeper understanding, and deeper realization of what the loving instructions of the Father is all about. Adam and Eve were in training in the garden. Adam was first and holds a greater responsibility by fulfilling the law of God in front of Eve. Romans 7:22 says again that Adam, a type of spirit, delighted in the law of the Most High. Eve, being the weaker vessel, was undergoing the process of being perfected in love, and her responsibility is to keep herself from being defiled. And how does she do that? Is to follow Adam wherever he goes. 2 John 1:6 says, "And this is love, that we walk according to his commandments. This is the commandment, just as you have heard from the beginning, so that you should walk in it." Our souls, our minds, our will, emotion, intellect is weak without the direction and guidance of our spirit, of our inner man, through the redemptive power of our Savior Yahushua HaMashiach. We need to discipline ourselves until we are mature enough to not be easily shaken. Until then, we need to take every thought captive and subject it to truth. Adam, as the type of Messiah, is the leader of the way, holds the truth and the commandment of the Most High, which leads to the tree of life. And so when Eve, or our soul, fell in disobedience and fell from the presence of God, we need to get back to the way first. Then we cross over from what was false and cross back to what is truth. By doing so, we are finding our way back to fellowship with the Most High, just like what it was like before the fall. Psalms 19:7 says, "The law," or the way, or the loving instructions of the Lord, "is perfect, reviving the soul." Our souls need to be converted. Our souls need to be revived. And the way we do this is by keeping obedience of what's already been given to us within our inner man, our inner man that delights in the law of the Father. And all of which Romans 10:5 to 8 says, it's not hard to obtain. The message of the gospel is very close at hand. It is on your lips and in your heart. In the next presentation, we will examine a little closer what the pronouncement of consequence that resulted from her actions leading to the fall of mankind. And you will see why there is a need for Eve or for our souls to be converted by truth, by the loving instructions of the Father through the Messiah. And we are to be conformed to the image of the Son. Be still and know.
The things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you.